auto rickshaw, a common mode of transport, has become an indispensable part of Indian life. The tempos, small goods carriers, are prominent vehicles on Indian roads. All these are innovations by the visionary industrialist Nawalmal Kundanmal Firodia. A dedicated Gandhian, his life was a confluence of knowledge, work and devotion. On the 9th of September 1910, in a small village called Kolgaon near Ahmednagar in Maharashtra, Nawalmal Firodia was born to advocate Kundanmal Firodia, a lawyer of repute, and his wife Baijabai. He was the oldest of the five siblings.
The love, affection, care and regard that the siblings, that is my father, his two brothers and his two sisters, the five of them, had for each other was exceptional. I have always wondered how they worked together, supported each other, respected each other. This is something which has been a great lesson for succeeding generations in trying to mold themselves. My father believed that the character of a child is formed by the ethical values that he inherits from his mother. The mother plays the more important role, the father contributes only peripherally. And this perception he gained from the experience of the values he inherited from his own mother, who was an extremely efficient, very capable, very affectionate, very hard-working lady, who also transformed herself eventually to mold herself along with her husband's ideals of nationalism and khadi. But deep down inside, she was religious, she was ethical, she was affectionate, and these qualities were inherited by him. And he always mentioned that the mother's character and the mother's values are most important because they mold the future generations of the nation.
Nawalmal grew up under the mentorship of his father Kundanmal Firodia, who shaped his destiny. A scholar and intellectual, Kundanmal was a gold medalist and a Dakshina Fellow of the Bombay University in 1907. In 1937, Kundanmal Firodia was elected to the Bombay State Legislature, and in the next assembly in 1946, he became its speaker. Fondly called Bhau Sahib, he was a staunch nationalist and a motivated Congress Party leader. It was at the tender age of 9 years that Nawalmal attended a Congress rally in Ahmednagar in 1919, hosted by his father. He was mesmerized with the inspiring speech made by Lokmanya Tilak. The nationalist fervor it aroused in him lasted a lifetime. After Lokmanya's death in 1920, the Indian National Congress moved from Tilak's individualistic nationalism to Gandhi's mass movement based on the principles of non-violence, truth and simplicity. It was along with his friends that Bhau Sahib established the Rashtriya Pathshala in Ahmednagar to inculcate in children Indian values and culture, dignity of labor and respect for vocations. Nawalmal too went to the same school. Here he learned carpentry as part of vocational training. With the art came the philosophy. When you create something or build something, you become stronger. The innovative bent of mind thus shaped manifested itself in his quest for industrialization, and he was destined to usher in iconic concepts for the common man. Little could one realize that the real spirit of the Indian independence movement and the education he imbibed in his formative years were actually steering a man of principles towards a manufacturing revolution. Aspiring to be an engineer, Nawalmal first enrolled himself in the Ferguson College in 1927 for undergraduate studies in science. He was asked to leave the college because he led a movement by nationalist students against the wishes of the college authorities. He had to move on to join the Royal Institute of Science in Bombay. The 28th of August 1930 was a turning point in Navalmal's life and career. He was witness to a brutal, unprovoked act of police atrocity in Bombay on highly respected national leaders of Gandhi's freedom struggle. A peaceful procession was mercilessly attacked, severely injuring many. Navalmal realized that the freedom struggle had reached a point where he simply couldn't be a bystander. He rushed back to his hometown Ahmednagar, determined to fight for the cause. Along with his father, Navalmal immersed himself in the Mahatma's fight for freedom. At the age of 20, he was made the General Secretary of the Ahmednagar District Congress Committee. Working in villages, he mobilized support at the grassroots level for Satyagraha. It was in 1932, when he was arrested during the non-cooperation movement, that he was subjected to a tough prison term. Here, he experienced the harsh side of British imperialism, witnessing fellow prisoners, including intellectuals like Sane Guruji, being tortured in prison. Freedom fighters then were not treated as political dissenters, but like common criminals. On being released from prison, Navalmal was married on the 16th of January 1933 to Jamna, the youngest daughter of Pune's leading merchant, Mr. Bhikam Das Pokarna. Jamna had been a student of the Maharshi Karve Girls' School. Navalmal's reformist nature was visible when he sought to change the traditions and the conservative customs of Rajasthani families.
Even though Baba's dress was traditional, he wore a khadi kurta and a khadi dhoti, his thoughts and his attitude to life was extremely modern. Not only did he insist that my mother should not have a ghungat at the time of her marriage, but he encouraged her to do many things which women in that time, in the 30s and 40s in India, particularly in our community, did not do. For instance, my mother used to take literacy classes for women. She learned to drive in the 30s. She played badminton. She used to swim regularly. So these are things which he encouraged her to do, which were extremely modern for their times.
Although his calling was in science and he completed his bachelor's degree, he chose to pursue law. This was a decision based on his father's advice to choose between the studies in electrical engineering in England, where he had secured admission to Faraday House, or become a lawyer and participate in the freedom struggle in India. Navalmal graduated as a lawyer in 1936 and joined his father's practice. His legal expertise not only strengthened his commitment to the freedom movement, but also enabled him later to successfully foray into industry. While practicing law, Navalmal was once again imprisoned on the 9th of August 1942, along with other freedom fighters, when Gandhi's call for Quit India triggered the final battle for India's independence. This imprisonment was all the more moving for Navalmal, as his father was also incarcerated in the Yeroda jail. Father and son shared a cell, enabling Navalmal to spend exclusive time with him, otherwise a rarity. He also got to interact with other freedom fighters. This experience gave a new direction to Navalmal's life.
शांत वातावरण मध्ये अनेक दिवस चर्चा केली. त्या विचारांच्या कारावासामध्ये आचार्य भागवत, आचार्य जावडेकर, साने गुरुजी इत्यादी थोर विचारवंतांचा, तत्वचिंतकांचा त्यांच्या तसल्या प्रबोधनाचा लाभ मिळाला. जीवनाला एक दृष्टी मिळाली. विचाराची एक बैठक बसली आणि त्यात ते सर्व विचार घेऊन पुढे जीवनामध्ये काहीतरी करता येईल अशी शक्यता निर्माण.
While in jail and with India's independence being imminent, Nawal Mal propounded to his freedom fighter friends that it was time to lead the new India into an industrial era. A close friend derisively pointed out to him the risks involved in industry. Nawal Mal was stung by this and soon declared that he would give up his legal practice, a courageous stance as he had no industrial background when he took on the challenge to explore the unknown.
India at that time in 1942 was a country without industry, without an infrastructure of science and technology, without a manufacturing base. Whatever had existed 100 years ago of textile industry or any other industry had withered during the colonial time. And he felt that for India to have its rightful place in the committee of countries in the world, industrialization was very necessary.
In 1946, Nawal Mal established his company Jai Hind Industries. His friend Karamsi Bhai Somaya graciously offered office space in his own office at Flora Fountain, Bombay to operate from. With the independence of India on the 15th of August 1947, Nawal Mal's dreams soared.
He gave his company the name Jai Hind Industries, very clearly indicating that this was something which had a very strong nationalist undertone, a nation building character. The second aspect, which is equally important but is not very largely known, is that his telegraphic address for the business, and in those days telegraphic addresses were very important because there were not so many telephones, and the telegraphic address actually conveyed the character of the company. And the telegraphic address was the Nek Bepar, which means honest business. So these were his thoughts and his approach. And when he consulted his father gave him wonderful advice. He said that first of all, you cannot do this business as a part-time business. You have to leave your activity and focus on it full time, but you have to give it only a number of years. If in 5 years you succeed, well and good, otherwise you should not get disheartened, but come back to legal practice. Second, during this period, you must keep your expenses to the minimum, and he specified a sum of 500 rupees per month. He said, keep your personal expenses within limits, so that you do not burden yourself in the process. And the third advice was equally sage, where he said that in starting the business, of course risks are involved, never mortgage your personal property or personal assets for the sake of the business. And I think taking these aspects, he then formed Jai Hind Industries and started off. A friend of his suggested that he should import typewriters and sell them, because that was the era of the typewriters. His first real manufacturing operation was the modern foundry, which was a small foundry set up in Ahmednagar by a technocrat who had no capital and was not able to run it, though it was done with the very best of intentions. And he took over that company, retained the person as a partner and started off.
Cycle rickshaws then were a common sight. But the inhuman method of pulling the rickshaw prompted the Home Minister at the time, Morarji Desai, to propose a ban on this mode of transport in the Bombay province. This was an opportunity for Nawal Mal to moot the idea of a three-wheeler motorized vehicle. In 1948, Jai Hind Industries entered into a joint venture agreement with Bajaj Trading Corporation, today known as Bajaj Auto, to fructify this concept. The joint venture was between the Firodia and the Bajaj families, and Nawal Mal was in charge of operations.
He wrote to the government and asked, if I bring a motorized small vehicle, will you accept? And the government said, yes, if it meets our requirement, we will accept it. And it is from this that he started to look for what can be an auto rickshaw. The word also he coined himself. And he obtained from Piaggio in Italy the chassis of a goods vehicle and designed, developed and built on it an auto rickshaw body which could carry people. It was very similar to the concept of a tonga, which in those days, a horse-drawn tonga was the real public conveyance available to people. And this auto rickshaw concept was very novel. The fact that 60 years and more after it was introduced, it is still the common man's public transport, testifies to the fact that it was a superb product positioning. The word auto rickshaw has become generic and it has entered the Oxford Dictionary thanks to his innovation.
He then showed the vehicle to Pandit Nehru, Sardar Patel and several other national leaders who tried it out. Impressed with its functionality, the government granted permission to register these vehicles as public conveyance. Permission to locally manufacture them was, however, not granted yet. In January 1949, the first office for sale of auto rickshaws was set up in Pune. Navalmal's younger brother, Hastimal, completed his master's in industrial engineering in America in 1950. However, until license to manufacture came by, Hastimal chose to work in Bombay State Transport to gain hands-on experience. In 1958, when the license to manufacture the three-wheeler was obtained, Hastimal joined Navalmal and led the technical activity of the business. Earlier in 1950, Navalmal Firodia went to Europe to look for opportunities for expansion and to bring in new technology for development. In Germany, for the first time, he saw the Tempo being used as a commercial vehicle. He figured that the load-bearing capacity of the Tempo was half a ton, which was roughly equivalent to the capacity of the Indian bullock cart. He entered into an agreement with Hamburg-based Vidal und Sohn to make Tempos in India. This agreement was facilitated by Mr. Rolf Bacher Sr. This led to a relationship spanning 60 years among the three families, Vidal, Bacher and Firodia, and the Indo-German bond, which has lasted till today. In August 1958, the first manufacturing plant was set up in Goregaon, Bombay, over 5 acres of land to produce the Tempo Hansiat three-wheelers, giving shape to Navalmal's project of bringing the Tempos to the Indian market.
Till now, 50 years down the line, you still see in rural Rajasthan and in Uttar Pradesh these vehicles operating. So both these concepts, the Tempo and the auto rickshaw, were very valid. The word Tempo has become generic in India for any small goods vehicle. It is not an English word denoting a small goods vehicle, but it has so become in common parlance. And this also is what I would say a new paradigm that was created, the auto rickshaw and the Tempo, and that is a massive contribution to the automobile industry. Jai Hind Industries, which he founded, entered into a joint venture with the Bajaj family. And in this joint venture, Bajraj Trading Corporation became the vehicle or the entity which was to carry forward his project of auto rickshaw. In 1960, having obtained then a license for manufacture of both the auto rickshaw and the scooter, Bajraj Trading converted to Bajaj Auto, which is the present company.
The business of manufacturing auto rickshaws created by Navalmal continues to be an important business of Bajaj Auto till this day, and the Firodia family continues to be an important shareholder in Bajaj Auto. India's restrictive license permit raj was an impediment for growth. Although General Motors and Ford impressed upon the government that it was easier to import vehicles to protect their imports into India, Navalmal and other Indian industrialists like Lalchand Hirachand were of the firm belief that India did have the ability to set up manufacturing indigenously. The government asked the Tariff Commission to evaluate this issue and set direction for policy.
Then Mr. Firodia got the license of producing this vehicle. This was an extremely tough task. At this point of time, India had been economic regulations. You could not produce what you wanted. You had to get a license for each and everything.
Very short time, because the government had imposed such tough conditions that you must start with 80% local content and you must go to 95% local content within 2 years.
There was a license granted to produce 1,000 vehicles per year. Now for automobile, 1,000 vehicles is nothing, you can say, and it is very, very difficult to manage this with a reasonable effort, because all manufacturing infrastructure you must create for a very, very limited number of vehicles, but somehow NK Farudia could manage it. I remember there exist pictures where they started to do aluminium casting, which were cast under a tree, really outside, no foundry, just heating up the aluminium and pouring into the dye, and the whole thing was hanging from a tree. It was really an adventurous exercise what they did at this point of time.